Hello everyone, I'm Priscilla Soma and I'm a medical doctor. I qualified in 1996, so I've been practicing since 1997 and I've loved each and every day of it. So in 1997, I started as a medical practitioner at the Steve Biko. That time it was called H.F. Verwoerd Hospital. In 2003, after I got married and had my first baby, a lecturing position became available in our faculty, which I then decided to apply for. So I'm teaching at the university since 2003, and students are forced to like me. I get them in their first year, their second year, their third year. When they think they just got rid of me, I do clinical medicine, I get them in their fourth year. In their fifth and sixth year, they invite me as an examiner. So I get lots of samosas from the students. Most of them are homemade, so it's nice teaching here. But today, I'm here to tell you what's it like to be a medical practitioner. Medicine, like all careers, has its pros and its cons. For me, fortunately, the pros has been much more. Have I thought at 2 o'clock in the morning when I had a patient coughing in my face, man, I should have become a hairdresser? Of course, that thought has crossed my mind. But being a medicine for most people is a calling. And we are all different, but making a patient who's coming with a stroke walk out of the hospital after a month of therapy is a service we deliver to mankind. So I usually tell students, I can teach you all the causes of heart failure, what causes diabetes, how to treat it, but I cannot teach you how to care for people. So if you do not have empathy for people, please, then there's engineering for you, there's accounting for you, there's IT, which are also important careers in our country, and there's a huge need for that as well. So we do take the cream of the crop. Most of our students have 10 and 12 distinctions. But it's disheartening to see them qualify and then they don't even greet their patient when they become doctors. So I need to correct that. So I'm currently working in physiology, normal functioning of the body. So I teach them hematology, neurophysiology. I do cardiovascular system. I do the respiratory system with them. What's it really like? You have to be dedicated. It's hard work. Many nights when you're on call, you don't even get a chance to sleep. Females, your biological clocks get dear mekaar, but we really do survive. I've even managed to have 2 children through all these 20 years of practice. I'd like to think they are much more normal than what I am. Yes, becoming a doctor is a long process, and we have to be patient. Good things in life are worth waiting for. What is the process I'm speaking about? First of all, it is true. Doctor's handwriting is illegible. Have you ever seen a prescription? Many times you can't even read the name of the drug or the dosage. But that is not what we use as criteria here at the University of Pretoria. Why is it so fantastic to become a doctor? Because the sky is the limit. You can become a medical practitioner, where you become a general practitioner, you have your own surgery, where you consult with patients. And yes, there's a dire need for good GPs in our community. I'm sure many of you have battled to get a GP on a Sunday afternoon at 2 o'clock, never mind 2 in the morning, nay. And I tell my students, it's the choice we make. If you want to become the flu and the grip doctor, that is your choice. Diagnose flu of the brain, flu of the chest, flu of the stomach. Nay, we don't want those kind of doctors out there in our community. We want doctors who really care. And so we try to model and be good mentors and role models for our students here at Turkey's. Or you could become a specialist. So many people are not satisfied being a general practitioner. Life's too boring, they say. They want to become a thoracic surgeon and do open heart surgery. So specialists range from a different disciplines. You become a pediatrician, a cardiologist, a kidney specialist. You can choose what you want to do. We'll see how long it takes you to do that. Or you can become a researcher. So part of our 2025 strategic plan, when you teach at the university like me, you have to do research. in order to improve medicine. Not research that gets published in the Huisgenoot or the U magazine. It has to be sound scientific, so we have to aim to publish in good medical international peer-reviewed journals. So currently for me, my research lies in diabetes and chronic inflammatory disease. My current project, we are looking for volunteers, diabetics, type 2 patients, for example. We want to do genetic studies on you. Is there a gene in our South African population that predisposes you to diabetes? Most research, as you know, is done on Europeans and Americans. And even those of you who don't want to hear it, we are very different from them. So currently we have about 89 patients in our study. The statistician said I need about 100 diabetics in order to show or disprove statistical significant results. So I'm nearly there. So soon you might see me on the Discovery Channel name. Or if you don't want to practice and work with people every day, you could become an academic where you can teach in various different settings. So I teach and I also do some clinical medicine. I have a session post at Steve Biko. I think as a lecturer, it's important to still be hands-on. You want to still listen to patients' hearts and lungs, know what a big liver feels like, what does abdomen in the fluid feel like. I think the clinical background makes me also a better facilitator when I teach my subject, because I know exactly what the patient with heart failure will complain about. And I think my students enjoy the clinical background that I've acquired before teaching my academic career. Pharmaceutical. So some medical students hate people after the 6 year. It just got a bit too much for them. What do they then do? They join a pharmaceutical company. The scope is huge. So many medical directors at most of the pharmaceutical companies are people who have an MBCHP. So there you can decide what is your field of interest. If you want to run the HIV program, you can work in the pharmaceutical company and run the HIV program. If cancer is your fancy, then you run the oncology unit. So there's many things you can do being a doctor. This is where the problem lies. So you do the Bachelor of Medicine, and once you complete it, you have an MBCHB degree. It is 6 years of academic training. 6 years sounds like a long time, but trust me, it flies by very quickly. I meet my sixth year students who were still my little children 6 years ago in the first year and in the second year. Now I have to address them as doctors as well. So that's very pleasing. So it sounds a long time, but the 6 years is what is required to become an efficient medical practitioner. In your second and third year, we introduce you to clinical medicine. So we have an LCAS program. Students get sent to small community clinics or little hospitals so that they can see what's it like to interact with people. In your fourth year, you start having official clinical training. So every morning from 8 o'clock to 12 o'clock, you are in our wards. Students spend 4 weeks in every discipline. So you will do 4 weeks pediatrics, 4 weeks internal medicine, 4 weeks surgery. At the end of the 4 weeks, for each and every discipline, there's an exam and a test. In the afternoons, between 2 and 5, they have to attend lectures. So they do a lot of reading. I always say the good medical student is identified with the flat buttock, because that's the one who is sitting and reading all the time. In your fifth year, we still have formal lectures, but not as abundant as in your fourth year. So more time in the hospitals, more time spending with patients. So our fifth years, for example, will be with the doctor in casualty till 8, 9 o'clock in the evening. We'll see from the time the patient enters casualty until we admit. So a fifth year student will be having their own patient, which they will admit and look after until they get discharged, under the supervision of the doctor in the hospital. In their sixth year, they work almost as interns. There's not real formal lectures. You are the slaves of our hospital. The poor students are drawing bloods. They're running to the blood bank. When I was in my sixth year, I think we used to get 200 rand a month, which was a lot of money then. I don't think government has any more money to give the 200 rand. Fortunately, after your sixth year, when you do your internship, you are getting a fantastic salary. And little bit starts making sense to all the hard work that you've had to do. You unfortunately have to do 2 years compulsory community service. So ladies, after all this, now you decide, oh, but I'd love to become an ENT surgeon. After this, it's another 4 years where you register as a registrar in the Department of ENT. So it's again exams, it's again anatomy, it's again physiology, and you learn the specific discipline. So if you want to become a cardiologist, you do 4 years internal medicine, post community service, and 2 years cardiology. Some specialties go 6 years. Again, salary has been quite fantastic from government sides, and our poor registrars who do all these calls manage to even buy some nice cars while they are working. What can you go and specialize in? You can become an anesthetist. You can become a surgeon. You can become a general surgeon, where you primarily work on the abdomen and do stomach, colon, those kind of surgeries. You can become a thoracic surgeon, where you do the valve replacements and you do all the coronary artery bypass. So usually we tease our thoracic surgeons. They think they are the most important people in the hospital because they do open heart surgery. And I think it does come with the territory, nay. It does sound like important surgery that they do. For me, measuring someone's blood pressure and treating a patient's high blood pressure is also saving lives, nay. And we don't have enough people doing that. Hypertension, a treatable condition, is so common. 1 in 3 people in our community have high blood pressure. What do we see at Steve Biko? People coming in with strokes, people coming in with heart attacks. Why? They did not know they had high blood pressure, a treatable medical condition. So I usually tell my students, when they open up their GP practices, they must promise to me they're going to make their receptionist or their nurse measure blood pressure of each and every person walking into their surgeries. So they all, with their nice bright blue and green eyes, promise they're going to do that. Nee. So hopefully one day, when I have lots of time, I'm going to visit them in their GP practices and see what will they do. The problem is most of them remember me very well. Nee. I'll have to go undercover. So again, just to show you more or less, the first diagram on the left is a cardiologist. And those are your ECG stickers, probably making this patient doing a stress ECG where they're running on the treadmill. So you study medicine, you do internal medicine for 4 years, and then you do 2 years cardiology. There's not many females in the discipline of cardiology, so ladies, here's an opportunity. Let's have this matric class becoming more cardiologists and more thoracic surgeons. We need to change the perception that medicine is a man's world, nay. The second on the right is a doctor who's specializing in nuclear medicine, like radiology, but just a bit different. So it's nuclear medicine where they inject certain radioactive materials. So for example, if I want to see if you have a tumor in your thyroid gland, I'll send you to the nuclear physicist to have a look at you. If you have a clot in your lung, a pulmonary embolus, I'll do a VQ scan and then they will do it for you. Unlike the radiologist who do the CT scan and the fancy x-rays. At the bottom, we have a lady. She's probably in the Department of Microbiology, where you are investigating if there's any infection, for example, in a person's abscess or in the blood. On the right, we have people who have to become pathologists and examine cause of death. The top left-hand side, your left-hand side, is the radiologist. So usually, if I have a patient with a stroke, I want to know, does this patient have a little clot, or is there a massive bleed in the brain? I'll send him to the radiologist for an MRI scan. On the right is the general surgeon operating on someone's abdomen. At the bottom is a brain that will probably be the work of a neurosurgeon. At the left, it's probably me just a common, simple, general practitioner. Then just to brag about why we're the best faculty, I'd just like to mention a few things on student support. We are very proud of the support we provide to our students. Right on top, Hatfield campus. It's a very sensitive topic. Prince of Campus is the main campus. No one refers to Hatfield as the main campus. Okay, so at Hatfield campus, we have an entire student support system made up of psychologists, clinical psychologists, social workers. I think they have a 24-hour service. So if you have a student who is suicidal, there's a helpline, and that student will be dealt with immediately. EMM stands for Examination Moderation Meeting. At our faculty, we meet after every semester. We go through the marks and see how our students have been performing. So if a student has got 80%, 70%, 75%, and then all of a sudden 30%, that student will get called in. What was the reason for the drop in the mark? Sometimes it's financial constraints. Sometimes it's my parents are getting a divorce. Sometimes it's relationship problems. So we usually want to address and see what was the cause for the drop in the mark. So our School of Medicine chair usually addresses all those double students. Then we have tutors. So our fourth and fifth and sixth year medical students usually perform the duties of a tutor for every little block or subject that we teach. And they do get a small amount of money, not even enough to buy airtime. Then we have mentors. I'm also part of the mentor program. When you are a first year and you come from the Northern Cape, this place is gray, the people are old, sometimes the grass is not even green. To assist the move and to facilitate, every first year will get a third year medical student mentor. Student is to guide you, to tell you where to get past papers from, which subjects can you skip lectures, which ones do you need to learn more. So it's social and academic, and we are divided into different subgroup leaders, and I'm a subgroup leader for some of the mentors that I have. Students with disabilities, we have an impaired student committee. So if you have a student on a wheelchair, that student will need special cares and needs. That will be identified before the student starts their lectures. Currently in my second year class, there are two students. It's not really a learning disability, but they need more time to complete an exam on the computer. So they've come with a special letter from the occupational therapist, which I then inform our exam monitors, so that students will get more time. Okay. Conceptual tutor, we have a Professor Lombard. He's coming from the Department of Theology. I think he's almost 80 years old. He looks 50-something. I'm scared to think what will happen when he retires. He speaks 12 or 13 languages, and he just really has that trick how to get the student who are battling into our campus. So I think some of the medicine that works really well with Professor Lombard, all him and his students are drinking lots of wine. So I'm not sure if that's what's making him so good. I'm thinking of also trying the wine story. Our students are fantastic, despite the heavy curriculum and burden of work. We have so many student committees and bodies, and the students are just not lazy to help their fellow students. So at the residence, they have their own mentors. Our day students have mentors. At the residence, they have their own mentor programs. And Pulse is our medical little magazine that comes out monthly. It's for the students, by the students. I am the guardian for Pulse, but I just usually check there's no major things that's not supposed to be in there. Too political or too much porn, those things I have to stop. Fortunately, I haven't had a problem with that. So Pulse is for the students, by the students. CIL is the computer literacy course. With our medical students' intake increasing to 300 and more, we cannot do so much of paper test. I mean, I can't go and read 300 papers of what are the causes of high blood pressure. By then, I'm also going to have high blood pressure once I mark the 300 scripts. So we usually do computer-based testing, and to ensure that our students are efficient with a computer, they do a computer literacy course in the first year, which is compulsory. Most students are really IT boffins, and they usually know more about the computer than the lecturers. So when I battle in class, if I can't get my presentation, there's more students that are able to help me. To reward them, I usually bribe them with 5% extra in the exam. Then we have language experts. So English is not first language for many of our students. So we also have people to assist you and to wean you into our campus. Our Faculty of Health Science, all the teaching is done in English. Even our exams for the last 2 years have also been in English. And we've done a survey a couple of years ago. 60 to 70% of students prefer to be taught in English. All the medical textbooks are in English. When they go abroad to work, it has to be English. So it's for me so different to see a student with the surname of Van der Merwe speaking in English in their sixth year exam. But times are changing now, so English seems to be the way we are going. I'm just upset my vernacular is not being offered at this university. ARV medication stands for antiretroviral. Unfortunately, we do have needle stick injuries. I've even had one when I was practicing medicine in 2002. So students get taught, they will get a little chart that's laminated to know exactly what to do when they had a needle stick injury. When does the needle stick injury typically occur? At 3 a.m. When there's no chemist, when you don't have your starter pack, when you can't get hold of a doctor. So students have a doctor assigned to them, and his cell number is printed on this little card. So parents, even those from the Northern Cape, we really do take care of your students. Northern Cape is special to me because I was born in Kimberley, and I did my internship there. Trust me, there's more to Kimberley than the Groot Gat, So when I started working here, they were really impressed with my Afrikaans because I learned all my Afrikaans in the Northern Cape. People don't even say hello in English in Kimberley, It's only Afrikaans there. So I think the Afrikaans has gotten to where I am and probably why I survived almost more than 20 years in this university, and I'm still loving it. Hopefully I can be here for another 20 years. So thank you very much, and hope you'll enjoy the rest of the day.